Give a talk, and we have used the name for it also, Revolt. This talk has been brought originally by my colleague Rudolf van den Berg, who initially said he shouldn't be here, but he is here. So Rudolf, please stand up. He did most of the work, and he is going to experience in a few days in the United States of America how bad it is, what I'm going to tell you. Who of you knows what voice over LTE is? Quite some hands. Second question, are there any Americans or Canadians in the room? In the hall? No, that's a pity. Because I could ask an interesting question to you. The question here is, should we stop the shutdown of 2G, 3G to save lives? The key point is, on the 1st of July, AT&T in the United States has stopped with 2G, 3G, and is now working with voice over LTE over 4G. And this is the first major country, really large country, who has done that. The core point here is that there is a lack of standardization in voice over LTE, which has been masked for everybody because your handset falls back to the original 2G and 3G. So most people aren't aware of it at all until you start shutting down. This is the presentation. There are some slides also with background material. There is not a site where we can upload, but I was explained that we can put a URL into the description. So we set it there. Rudolf already has given the presentations two times before and already put slides on internet and on accounts. But there. This is effectively a call to everybody who is currently involved here in MCH 2020, who is looking at it via the streaming. The call for everybody who is currently doing some work on voice over LTE, which is the voice application that would run over the data network, who work for a telecom operator, an MVNO, a mobile virtual network enabler that's supporting handsets, and what we also have IMS platform builders. The reason is, if you also maybe already have bumped into issues, you could share to us and we can deliver it confidential. But we also have a call for people who work for emergency services or who are in the car industry and working on e-call. That is a car making a call to emergency service when you have a collapse or a crash. We have put it up a bit in the Netherlands now and also at the European Commission, but most countries aren't aware that this is coming and effectively is now starting to happen. You can contact my colleague Rudolf van den Berg, who just waved his hand, and or myself, and I am the last one. And we go to the meet. The reason is, 30 years ago about 2G started really starting to do the first field trials and has been done with a lot of industry cooperation, and they have been quite a success, so much a success that even in the United States a number of operators moved from the American standard to the European, and it effectively have delivered global roaming, and you can use 2G, 3G, especially when 3G came, Japan also became compatible nearly everywhere. And the key ideas were original GSM, the 3G UMTS SIM cards, built-in emergency call number. In Europe it's 112, but in America it's 911. And it works with every operator, even without a subscription. This is all going to the drain now, with voice over LTE and 4G. And it wasn't discovered because devices fall back to 2G, 3G mode. If you're moving now into the United States and you're AT&T, you get a welcome. Welcome, you're roaming on AT&T. Due to network technology incompatibility, this is meant voice over LTE compatibility, traditional voice calls will not work. Please use data, SMS, and app-based calling. We're going to explain that in a number of countries, SMS also doesn't work, which is nice if you do two-factor authentication with SMS. Swedish can't get his SIM working in the USA. France, Free is an operator, Iliad, and they got a choice. Either get data roaming with AT&T or for a subset of their users, voice roaming would work and data roaming. So they chose one. There are some URLs on it, but now T-Mobile was initially stating it would also shut down, but it shut down its 3G in the USA. It still has some 2G working, but T-Mobile USA is not the best coverage operator, so it become an adventure. Why is Swedish not working? It turns out their country is too small to start up roaming testing. It's broken, effectively. It's for Dutch people broken, Germans, British. We start to get all kinds of messages from people after the first posts on LinkedIn and all the platforms were made by Rudolf. Can't call, SMS, and internet works. My calling doesn't work. I can only call via T-Mobile. I have my bundle, it doesn't work. There has been some media coverage now going, starting to in May, June, but it's really, really beginning. In Germany, there's also some about Vodafone customers who have problems. Well, what's really... There's already a warning going out. Canadian Wireless Telecom Association. They are warning what can be done. And there is voice and 4G LTE without roaming capability. Voice service, including emergency calls in AT&T, won't work for Canadians. Always. And there is no impact on data service. Data roaming has been done when 4G was introduced and reasonably well tested, but the voice app was secondary. Here's the real issue coming up. Consumers can't see it. Apple decided to see incompatibilities, varieties, options, and it was too complex to do some shortcuts and also to ignore some settings. iPhone mostly works, but if you're buying a Samsung S20 for 5G, so quite modern device, the devices with a U do work, the ones with an N don't. So even in the type of device you have doesn't say what works, what doesn't work. There are some painful settings. Where is this coming from? This is coming from deals. Deals between handset manufacturers and big operators who buy a bunch of handsets. So the first guideline is don't travel. If you want to do something with faulty and with 112 calling, take an iPhone because Apple neglects some settings. Use the biggest mobile network in your country, because then maybe the roaming is fixed earlier, because AT&T looks at the size of the nations where they can do a roaming agreement, and they started with the largest countries in the world for there. Buy a new phone, because old phones aren't updated probably anymore. You should live in a big country. Sweden is too small. Netherlands is just at the edge. Stay at home and stay with the network and use postpaid. The reason is, we also ran into details that mobile virtual network operators, also probably because they don't use handsets, seems to have been blacklisted, whitelisted in some of the chipsets in mobile phones to get it working. So if you're using a mobile virtual network operator who doesn't buy a big chunk of handsets from a major handset manufacturer, chances are low that you get things working. There is an issue with emergency calling, and why are we pushing the emergency calling line? In European telecoms regulation, the real one item that's still a stick in the hands of politicians and regulators is the 112, the emergency calling. If you don't have that working, you can be hit out quite hard by politics. But nobody was aware of it. This is only presented by Rudolf in the late of April to the European Emergency Number Association, and most of them were completely flabbergasted and shocked that this was coming, this train. But this is what in Germany Vodafone puts out over Notruf mit voice over LTE. So what's the issue? It's not backwards compatible with the old cores of circuit switching. There are more than 700 LTE networks, 232 offer voice over LTE in 106 markets. Slightly more than 50 have roaming agreements. Having a roaming agreement, there was a few days ago an announcement of the Slovakian telecom operator. They have 4 international roaming agreements. So maybe Denmark doesn't work. So if you're going to travel in from Slovakia on your holiday to Denmark, your voice over LTE phone might not work. Still, currently everywhere in Europe tends to fall back to 2G, 3G, so most people don't discover it yet. But we want in Europe also to shut it down. Some testing, Bundesnetzagentur has done some testing, and about 50% of the German SIM cards are on phones that can't use voice over LTE. And still, we see the announcements that 2G, 3G network will be shut down in 2025. So this has now started to air. There is a body, the GSM Association, and the problem is they put out profiles, but it says this is non-binding permanent reference document. So it's non-binding. The most recent one was the 18th of July. I checked it yesterday evening light if what we stated here was still correct, but they haven't changed it yet. They have discussed that they have said your end user device must support both IP version 4 and IP version 6 and a set of protocols. The point is, not all networks do both. You might be on an IP version 6 network and going to roam to an IP version 4, and somewhere your device doesn't flip because there are some intricacies. So the texts are not quite right. People are starting to point their fingers to each other. They should do the change. They should make the change. And some regulators have not been aware of this. So in the Netherlands, voice over LTE and voice over Wi-Fi was for emergency service implemented. Lots of pressure from the regulators. And now incompatibilities are going to break it again. So the GSM Association says the shutdown is coming soon. They say sometimes 2G going down, 3G is not always perfect. Sometimes an operator shuts down 3G, a network not operates still 2G or vice versa. But the idea is now America and parts of Asia starts to happen. And Europe. Why is this an issue? We've gotten a message back, Rudolf, from an IT manager who was on holiday in India. And he was in an area where there was only 4G coverage. He got an emergency and to log in remotely from his holiday address. He had two-factor authentication, and the two-factor came to him via SMS. It doesn't work anymore. So he couldn't log in. So it hits far more than you think. Now I'm hitting out. So who needs to act? Well, you can act and start to raise alarm also in your own country, contact members of parliament, talk to telcos if they are aware of it, not all of them, talk to manufacturers, talk to standard organizations. Manufacturers go further than, the device ones. Chipset manufacturers have sometimes influence too in settings. So it's really the entire industry which is screwing up. The government, shutdowns have been announced in most countries. They should stop. There is some suspicion by us that there is antitrust mechanisms working. That's favoritism for certain firms. Business favoritism, so maybe they are starting to collapse the entire mobile market structures in countries by technical means. And you should demand that it should be interoperable. It has been working for decades with 2G, 3G. This is a screw up. And demand. The demand global access is effectively enforceable by law, but key point for governments is that they also should start verifying and testing, which they don't do because the market solves everything today. This same applies for telecom operators, and many of them will now need testing and aid and knowledge. And it can go down really to device versions even, if things work. And especially if there are some tricks like whitelisting certain mobile network codes and others not, it can be very tricky because everything seems to work. Most extreme case I've heard was someone who had an Android phone, didn't get voice over LTE working, took out the SIM card, put it in an iPhone, got it working, put the SIM card out, put it back in the Android, it works. So there are a lot of issues going on, but there is a lot of test and fixing and testing needed. It's currently a month needed to test and fix. That's because it's so complex. Effectively, the standards body should collapse all these options into a simple set of profiles. Well, Apple did it a bit, but Apple effectively just neglects some settings, which is very problematic if you want to use that part of field in the protocols, because suddenly you can discover that Apple doesn't work anymore well as you expected. The key issue is operators and telecom operators especially start to save the sharehold model, and compliance issues should be avoided. But this is pan-European, and effectively a phone bought in Sweden might work in Sweden and then brought to the Netherlands might not work anymore here, but an operator here. So burner phones, I don't know how they will do it soon in the future. The first presentation was given late April by the European Emergency Numbering Association, EENA. They were quite surprised. AT&T effectively continued shutdown. We have contacted via some people in the United States, a consumer advocate and the telecom specialist. He went to the FCC commissioners, the Democrats, they weren't interested. Thank you very much. That's quite well in time. I'm going to have some questions for you now. Time. We have the Dutch government taking action. There has been inquiries for parliament to the ministry. They are now trying to set up a first meeting on the issue in September 2022, but not every operator, not every MVNO, not every MVNA is aware of it already, that this is really a problem and screw up. There were some off-the-record messages like emergency calls to USA. What makes it different? If you call 911 in the USA, you end up somewhere in a state. In voice of LTE, it will be directed by the core here of your home operator, and he uses the GPS coordinates given to him to know in which state you are. So not everything is already working in that realm too. So there are really complexities and complexities coming up. Outbound roaming, inbound roaming. Now, the eCall worked on in cars because GSM worked. This wasn't quite probably known or isn't still known in the car industry how it's just screwed up just when it's introduced. There will be now some... I have some slides more or less explaining how bad things are and some final slides who we are. But I have also space and room for questions from the room. So I can do the backgrounders, but I can also do the questions. Are there a lot of people who want to ask a question? Yeah.
And then ask the question.
Okay, hi, thanks for the talk. So, like, if you take the SIM card out of your UE in, let's say, US, where they shut down the 2G and 3G networks, so does that make it easier for the emergency call to go out using the VoLTE network, or does it, like, is it only dependent on the UE implementations of the VoLTE stack?
Can you give rid of the microphone, or okay, you answer it on the microphone.
Yes. So I'm the weird guy who looked some of this up first. So in theory, anonymous calls should work over VoLTE, except that when I talk to VoLTE testers, they tell me that, well, you know, on T-Mobile, they had an issue that T-Mobile sent the wrong codes for an emergency call. And it needs to send, I think, a 380, and it sent a different call, a different code. And so when they complained to T-Mobile, like, yo, guys, you're sending the wrong code, so our phone isn't processing the code correct for an emergency call, the response came, well, it works on an iPhone. So they checked on the line what the iPhone did, and basically the iPhone just ignores the entire packet and error code and just looks if there's a server address in there and tries to make a call to the server. And if that works, well, then you have an emergency call. Brilliant. That there's other stuff in the packet that might need checking. Nope. It works. So basically, that was T-Mobile US's solution. If you just ignore whatever we send you and just take whatever you can use to make an emergency call, you should be fine. AT&T does IPv4 on its normal VoLTE network, but somehow did IPv6 on its emergency calling network. Not every phone understood that it needed to do a context change for emergency calls. Plus, there are some folks who go like, well, the GSMA standard says both networks need to do IPv4, or the network needs to do both IPv4 and IPv6. I have checked, it only does IPv6. That's wrong, that's not per the standard. It should do both, so I won't do an emergency call. That is a bit too strict an interpretation of the standard. The GSMA could have fixed that, it didn't. Hasn't yet. And so this is the kind of shit that we're running into, and that's why I'm getting annoyed. If this was just about voice calling, and it's not my problem, you know, it's telco shooting themselves in the foot and killing roaming revenues, etc. Well, you know, what else is new? We've been seeing that for decades. But because this is emergency calling, and I really want to be able to dial 911 or 112 when somebody is in trouble, and this is a European right, and it should work in every European country, as we all agreed in 1991. That's why I get annoyed. And thanks, Hendrik, for doing the talk, because I wasn't supposed to come, but still, awesome.
Okay. Are there some other questions? Okay, I can give some few examples about how bad things are and how disastrous it gives. every example makes it more painful. So our current plea is that you should get the emergency calling working for 112 and so on, and effectively it's in the law, so you can even call your parliamentarians to just maintain the law. But your operators don't have an argument, but how they break it. Also, this is not a phone compatible with our network is a bit difficult to maintain. And we have also put it into consumer organizations in Europe. They have, in some countries, been to Supreme Courts about back older devices updating by suppliers. This might be a next run for the same issue, because not every judge got that quite issue why it was an issue. It shouldn't have been a problem, but effectively for quite some years they didn't look at it, and they weren't called on because you had the fallbacks. There is a number of issues who are effectively have to go in, consumer authorities, Commission even. It's also fine if you work for a company and your executive is going to travel to the USA next week and you're buying phone service for him. The firmwares, this was really the surprise, whitelists should never have been there. Who got that ID is very peculiar. And of course, yeah, then you get, why do they screw this up? Many people, many around, all kind of visions, no choices. And it was a side issue, and it was a side issue, and now it isn't anymore. And then the real problem, we've seen this with spam about 15 years ago. There are some people in the commercial departments who think a bit different about this, want to link things about sales of new devices, sales, new equipment. And so if you're going from maybe with your same device to another operator, maybe it doesn't work. Well, yeah, that's effectively not the way it should work. But it's needing a lot of testing. There are some issues with IP version 4 and IP version 6, and I let it sink in a bit. Blacklisted and whitelisted handsets, chipsets, manufacturers. So even the device manufacturers point to Broadcom or to Qualcomm as being the culprit. Back to standardization. This is the Revolte, and I'm in the last minutes. Yeah. That's quite a... It should be done right. There should be a lot of testing and effectively figuring out what's working, what's not working, why it's not working is needed for the coming years. It should work everywhere, but it certainly not isn't working in this way. 5G doesn't going to save you because it is an issue of IMS and in the software layer. It's not about the radio interface. So that's why you have the problem. And of course, it would save lives. And we plea for a stop on 2G, 3G shutdowns before this isn't fixed, because that will be very dangerous, and effectively it is. I put up, this was my own slide, where I can be contacted, and this is Rudolf, what you're seeing here. Thank you very much.